Earth's most ubiquitous life forms tend to be generalists, species whose individuals can adapt to eating just about anything, anywhere. But the flowering plant family known as orchids have gained a global presence by being specialists, with each species customized to a very specific habitat. And behind orchids' wild variety of looks and behaviors are the same few stingy strategies. For one, while other flowering plants send their seeds off with a supply of victuals to get them growing, orchids don't. Instead, their seedlings must trick fungi into feeding them until they're old enough to photosynthesize their own food. At that point, some species start giving back, but others hoodwink their fungal partners into lifelong one-way relationships. In fact, several are so dedicated to mooching that they don't even have the ability to produce their own sugar. And many orchids also cheat their pollinators. While most flowers offer snacks to the critters who transfer their pollen, orchids have a rich array of disguises that make them look or smell like the pollinators' potential mates or their favorite sugar-filled flowers. For example, Australian hammer orchids look and smell like flightless female wasps. But when a male tries to carry her off to mate, he catapults instead into the flower's sex organs, sometimes picking up a sticky packet of pollen. Then there's the orchid's choice of real estate. Instead of setting down roots in a patch of rich soil, and then having to waste energy competing with other plants for light and nutrients, most orchids settle in inhospitable, low-rent locations like bare bedrock, soggy bogs, or the branches of trees. Orchids have customized these miserly habits, mooching off of fungi, cheating pollinators, and choosing cheap real estate, to habitats ranging from sub-Antarctic islands to tropical rainforests. And in the process, they've blossomed into an astounding 25,000 species, most of which are specialized to live in only one particular place with its particular conditions. And their wild variety and exotic looks have not escaped our notice. During the so-called orchid delirium in 19th century England, rich aristocrats sent orchid hunters off to scour the tropics for rare, valuable finds. The hunters even sometimes torched or razed the forest behind them in a quest for exclusivity. Today, it's illegal to collect or trade wild orchids, but tens of thousands of flowers are sold on the black market each year, some for tens of thousands of dollars. And while orchid hunters themselves no longer chop down whole forests, vast swaths of prime orchid habitat are lost to deforestation each year, putting thousands of orchid species at risk of extinction. And yet, orchids' diverse splendor may actually help save them, thanks to the devotion of a global network of orchid files. In 2010, police in England stood guard around the clock to protect the country's last wild lady slipper orchid from thieves. And in Ecuador, home to some of the highest densities of orchids in the world, conservationists established rainforest reserves to save the remarkable-looking Dracula orchids. Meanwhile, Australian citizens are building fences to protect threatened spider orchids from grazing rabbits and kangaroos. And scientists in the US are breeding rare cigar orchids in the lab and planting them in their native habitat in South Florida. All to save a bunch of plants that lie, cheat, steal, and ooh, that one's pretty. Hey, Emily here. Thanks to Curtin University and the University of Western Australia for sponsoring this video. Also, special thanks to Kingsley Dixon and the rest of the folks in the Orchid Specialist Group of the IUCN's Species Survival Commission for sharing their expertise with us. The specialist group is dedicated to helping orchid files around the world learn more about Earth's most diverse plant family in order to protect and restore orchids and their habitats.